Scripture reading this morning is taken from Mark chapter 8, verses 34 and 35. And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it."
Let's bow. Almighty Father, we're so very glad that you've given us this opportunity on this first day of the week to come and spend this time together in worship and praise to you, Lord. We know, Lord, that we have a lot to be thankful for. And when we look at our lives and we can see the things of this world and the ways in which we struggle here in this life, that we know that you have provided a place for us in eternity that is free from struggle and pain, from tears and heartache. Father, we thank you that you are with us and that you are constantly working with us to make us better in this world, that we can be refined, that we can be disciplined in such a way that we will become like your Son, Jesus. As through him we pray, amen. So we've been working on Sunday mornings a theme, a Christian survival guide of sorts, in which the Christian or the church looks at our relationship with the world. And as we look at that, we can see that as Americans, in our first citizenship that we hold, we have always been a people that has railed against injustices that have happened, that we have risen up and stood against that which we found was not right in this world. Going right back from the American Revolution, where we see colonists dressing up as Native Americans and throwing tea into Boston Harbor, we can see that this was not something that we were going to put up with all the taxes that England was putting upon us. And when we fought that war, the English decided that they were going to call us bumpkins, basically, and came up with a song, Yankee Doodle. But at Yorktown, when the English surrendered to us, we proudly played Yankee Doodle as they paraded through us after they had surrendered. So this is the kind of people that we are as Americans in our first citizenship. When there was injustice going on in the 1960s, we see that Rosa Parks decided that she was going to sit at the front of the bus and go against that. And even today, there's a lot who are protesting against how the government treats us. And maybe you've heard the cries of "Let's go, Brandon," that are constantly being out there even just today. And so for a Christian, what is it that we can do to rail against injustices that we see in the world? Most Christians think that we're just supposed to sit back and take it. But that's not really what God tells us to do. Instead, we can rebel against the injustices of this world by obedience. It's a very different thought, isn't it? Obedience. This 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 18 begins by saying, "Give thanks in all circumstances." While this world is giving thanks only when things go well for them, we can obey, we can rebel against this world and how this world treats us by being thankful in everything. No matter what comes our way, we know it's going to be okay. As we sing in the kids' song, because I'm happy, 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 happy today. And so today we're going to be taking a look at how it is that we can live for God in this very difficult world and culture that we live in by obeying Him, by living for Him, and how that goes right against what the world would want us to do and just taking it. To rebel against this world, we must choose man's weakness. Our main passage today is going to be Mark chapter 8, our scripture reading that we had, verses 34 and 35. And it begins by saying, "And calling the crowd to him with his disciples," this is of course Jesus speaking, "he said to them, 'If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself.'" We're going to stop there for just a moment. And what does it really mean to deny himself? If we are to go after Jesus, if we are to rebel against this world and live differently than this world, then we need to leave what is easy. What's easy? Sin is easy. Following the crowd is easy. Giving in to the values and beliefs and things that this world holds dear and saying, "No, I'm going to deny myself. I'm going to leave what is easy and follow Jesus." That is a very different path to come after him. In some ways, the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapters 5 through 7 is a declaration of independence for the Christian. It's a way to rebel against this world that we're living in. And when Jesus gave that to us, it helped us to turn the world's wisdom and power on its head and live differently than the world would have us live. The world would say, "Hey, we're stronger than you, we're more powerful than you. Your job is just to sit back and take it because you're weak and you can't do anything else about it." But Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you, blessed, and persecute you, and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account." How is that blessed? "Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." And so Jesus takes everything that the world says is weakness and turns it upside down and says it's really rebellion against this world. That we don't have to just sit back and take it. We can be active in our fight against the world by living for God. A Christian finds his strength in weakness. Jesus, of course, went to the cross. That was the ultimate act of weakness in submitting to the wickedness of man and allowing everything that happened to him to happen and go and be killed at the hands of wicked men. And those who have realized that there is strength in this kind of weakness are those who have also become great in this world. Ones like Gandhi, ones like Martin Luther King Jr., those who have recognize that there is a way to rebel against the strength of this world by becoming weak and living for God instead. As we continue in the Sermon on the Mount, we see here in Matthew chapter 5, it says, "But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you." To deny yourself is difficult. It's very hard because everything you want to do is just the opposite. That which is worldly within us still wants to rise up and do things the way we've always done them, the way that others have done them to us. But to deny ourselves is to do the things that Christ would do in our place because we are in Christ and Christ is in us. And so that is why we love our enemies and why it is that we pray for those who persecute us. the lady who, 19-year-old, who hit me in a head-on accident 2 weeks ago yesterday, reached out to me yesterday. I had, through a friend, asked to let her know that if she, that I forgave her, and that if she ever wanted to change her life around, that I would welcome her here to church. And so she sent me a message just last night. And she apologized for everything that she had done and put me through. And then she says, when I heal up and I can walk in about 6 months, she says, I would like to come to church. And I says, we'd love to have you. Love to have you. And just this morning, I had a friend request from her on Facebook. But isn't that what we're supposed to do? Rebel against this world and the way that the world would handle situations? For all for the kingdom of God? Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount continues and says, for if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? The people in this world, this is how they live, but not us. And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. To rebel against the world, we must choose God's strength. Our main passage continues and says, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross. Take up his cross. In other words, do what is hard to do. We've got to leave what is easy, but we also need to do what is difficult to do. In another passage that we're looking at this morning in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, there are a lot of very active verbs here that we have as things that we must do. All of these actions are taking up your cross and doing what is difficult. He says that we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle. Well, maybe that one's not so difficult. It's easy to say, hey, you lazy bones, get up. Do what you're supposed to be doing. But encourage the faint-hearted. Help the weak. Be patient with them all. That one's a little more difficult. Be patient with them all. Even the ones that are making you impatient, especially as we might stand in lines, especially as people are driving in crazy ways down Grand Central. There's a lot of reason to not be patient with folks, especially at this time of year. But we need to be patient with them all. See that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Rejoice always. Always. There's never a time when you shouldn't rejoice. Pray without ceasing. I'm skipping verse 18 on purpose for this moment. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good after you've tested it. Abstain from every form of evil. There's a lot of things that we as Christians need to do, and these things that we need to do are hard to do. These are the equivalent of picking up our cross and following Jesus. My wife and I had a tradition every Christmas Eve. We would take a selfie. And so you can see the difference in these two pictures from 2019. And then as we got into 2020, in March, when she realized that she had brain tumors again, in late July, when she went on palliative care and then on hospice care, and then the picture in 2020 that was taken 11 days after she passed. It's a big difference there. And I might be tempted to not give thanks in all circumstances. But I chose to do what was hard. I chose to pick up that cross and follow Jesus. And so how do we do that? How do we make that decision to do what is hard? First of all, we must look for the good even in the bad circumstances that seem to be happening to us. We need to look for God in those circumstances and how His presence is there and helping us along the way. And then we need to trust in God fully, even in the midst of all those difficult circumstances. What might they be? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 18 says, "Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." Finances are struggling this time of year. The economy as bad as it is. Your kids are having struggles. Maybe it is that you're not doing so well at work, or you're struggling in some other way. People are saying mean things against you. Your health isn't what you'd like it to be. In all circumstances, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. It's God's will that you give thanks in all circumstances. And if you can do this, then you are rebelling against this world. Because this world says, "I can only give thanks when I see things that are going my way." But a Christian lives differently. And a Christian rebels against this world by denying himself, taking up his cross, doing what is difficult in the midst of terrible circumstances to say, "Thank you, Lord, for being my God who loves me, who has saved me, and is helping me even now through this difficult and terrible situation." That's how it is that we rebel against this world. This is what Jesus chose. Luke chapter 22, verse 41 to 43, right before he goes to the cross and he's in the garden, it says, "And he prayed, saying, 'Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done.' And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him." He recognized that his Father had a will for him that didn't quite meet the vision that he, in the flesh, wanted to do. I'm sure that in the flesh, everything was crying out for him to run away from that garden, do what he can to avoid the cross that was there before him, that he knew he had to do because his Father's will said he must. And yet he was able to work around in prayer, thanks in all circumstances, and say, "Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." Angels strengthen him. And I always think, and especially in this past year, that I had angels strengthening me too. That God sent, as he says in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 14, these ministering spirits to those who will inherit salvation. That perhaps I had heavenly strength to help me get through and to continue giving thanks in all circumstances. We can only do that if we are a living sacrifice. Romans chapter 12 tells us, "Present your bodies as the living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world." In other words, don't live like they do and have the same values and attitudes, maybe only different in degree, but not by character. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. We must do the will of God to rebel against this world. To rebel against this world, we must choose Jesus' path. As we continue in our main passage, it says, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." What does it mean to follow Jesus? What does it mean to walk in his footsteps as he trudges up that hill to Calvary, and where he is going to be mocked and spat upon, where he was beaten, where he faced all kinds of torture and torment, people mocking him, where he was nailed to the cross, and where he hung there to die? It's a difficult path. If you think that your Christian life is easy, then you're doing it wrong. But how is it that we can try to explain Jesus and the path that he walked to others? So oftentimes we try to show Jesus as a very mild-mannered, just like the world would want us to be, and whatever we come at you with, just take it, just take it. And that's not what Jesus is to be at all. And I think we do folks, but also our young boys especially, a disservice when this is all that we show Jesus as being. It's hard for them to understand that Jesus as the Lamb of God is God concealed, but as the Lion of Judah, he is God revealed. That picture in Revelation chapter 19, how he's faithful and true, and how he is on the rider on the white horse with a sword coming from his mouth to judge the nations. This is also Jesus. And this is also something that we need to understand, that as we walk the same path that Jesus walked, we are walking that path that leads us to Calvary, yes, but we are also riding along with him to victory. And so we ought to walk in the path that he has showed us. And what is that path while we're here on earth? 1 John chapter 2, but whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. He walked in obedience. He walked in submission. He walked in difficulty. And that's the walk that we are called to walk if we are to come after him. Now, there were some that could see the path as Jesus was ready to go to the cross. And we just had this passage in a recent study in our book of Matthew. But here, those James and John who wanted a special privilege and special positions within the kingdom, they had their mother come to Jesus and say, I want these two sons of mine to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in your kingdom. And Jesus answered and said, you do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am to drink? And they said to him, we are able. Here the path was laid out before them, but they didn't quite understand it yet. They didn't recognize what the path really was all about and just how bitter that drink was going to be that Jesus himself was going to drink, and that they said that they were ready to drink themselves. But are we willing to suffer as well? To walk that same path as Jesus did? The footsteps that leads up to Golgotha? We can read in Matthew a little bit later on, a sneak preview at upcoming study. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews! And they spit on him, and they took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him. And by this lamb going to the slaughter, who was silent before his accusers and torturers, he showed the world, didn't he? He showed the world in that rebellion, in that God's strength, in that man's weakness. He was able to rebel against this world and bring about triumph for all those who would come after him. If you're only different than the world by degree, but not in character, if you're giving in, then how is your example to the rest of the world? How is the gospel message that is heard from your lips heard by those who see you compromising and living according to the world's standards and not rebelling against this world? If you haven't been rebelling against this world by dying to sin and to self, and being buried with him in baptism and being risen to walk in newness of life, this is an opportunity as we extend an invitation now to you to come forward as we stand and sing a song of invitation. And if you have already obeyed but haven't been living in rebellion to this world by living for God, this is also an opportunity for the encouragement and the prayers of the church to help you at this very time. Please stand.